Yeah, greetings, my fellow freedom loves and sovereign thinkers. This is LL3's newest podcast. My name is Craig, transmitting from the beautiful swampy mangroves of South Florida. And today's date, it is Wednesday, November 23rd, 2016. Absolutely, Thanksgiving Eve. So I know school's off today, and many people out there shopping, and tonight people are going to get hit the bars and the clubs because they're going to get totally intoxicated so they can deal with their in-laws, okay? Or the family members they're butting heads with. It happens all the time. I don't know why. I just get a big kick out of it, man. I'm like, wow. But so, so it's like, just some interesting things are occurring as usual. Stuff is happening in the Benghazi area with the human rights issues in Libya. Thank you, Hillary and Obama, and NATO for making that happen. You are so patriotic, right? Right. Real freedom lovers, to be exact. But if they were Republicans, everyone would be protesting the streets in anger. Ah, get these fascist, racist pigs out there. But it's from their party. Oh, they're okay. It's exceptional because we're a bunch of hypocrites. It goes the other way around as well, just to give you folks a heads up. So I'm just going to go too crazy today. It's going to do some basic topics. And I say this, let's just start this off from the freethoughtproject.com. And I know there was a petition on there as well. And it says here, it's by Claire Burnish. And it says here, Washington lawmaker proposes bill to charge protesters with economic terrorism. And go on here, it says, rather than working to abolish some of the thousands of illogical, irrational laws in the United States, criminalizing ordinary, mundane behavior, one legislation dream yet up yet another means to give us a criminal record, economic terrorism. And Washington State Senator Doug Erickson's new bill, however, only hazily concerns economics. Instead of the proposed legislation dressed in the sheep's clothing of criminalizing rioting constitutes a predatory attack on the First Amendment protected activity, protest. It's funny, but if the banksters, does that include the Federal Reserve and Wells Fargo's that they could be considered economic terrorists? Mr. Erickson, that's a good question you should just send to that Yahoo, especially on Thanksgiving, right? All right, I'll continue on here. Erickson has prepared a bill for next year's legislative session that would create a new crime of economic terrorism. The senator's website states the measure will allow felony prosecution of those who intentionally break the law in an attempt to intimidate or coerce private citizens or the government by obstructing economic activity. Interesting. So, or the government. So that's interesting. Okay. Well, we'll just keep on going here. And and he talks about the bill on his website. There's a link for that in this article. And I like when he says here, timely measure criminalizes illegal protests and causing economic damage, applies to unlawful disruption of transportation or commerce, allows troubled damages against funders and organizers. Something to look at. And I'll proceed here. Erickson is apparently sick of death of protests, peaceful or otherwise, and hopes to target activists who occasionally disrupt the flow of commerce or block traffic. Such demonstrations, whatever ire they provoke from those who would rather maintain a routine of sleep, work, eat, repeat, often represent the sole outlet for people who feel their grievances have fallen on lawmakers' deaf ears. The First Amendment of the Constitution, that's the right of the people peaceably to assemble and to petition the government for a redress of grievances. As Fox News pointed out when introducing Erickson of an interview recently, looting, rioting, property destruction, and the like, what the bill appears superficially to target, are already illegal. Thank you very, of course. Whether that makes the soon-to-be-proposed legislation redundant or belies its true and underlying intent to make constitutionally protected protest illegal appears to be alarmingly open question. The first thing to be clear about that, you have the right to protest, he told the host on Fox News. And you can protest Mr. Trump all you want. You can misspell fascism on a sign and carry it around the street. That's not what we're going after. What we're targeting are the people who take it to the next level. You have the right to protest. You don't have a right to do harm to people or to personal property. And this is intended to protect the citizens of my state and people around the country from those that get out of control. So, it's interesting here about that. This is mainly, if I'm correct, he's a state senator in Washington, right? Yeah, so it's mainly a state senator in Washington. And I go on here. However, Erickson has quite the narrow definition for acceptable forms of protest. According to his site, the measure would create a Class C felony aimed at causing economic disruption, jeopardize human right, life, and property. It would not apply in cases of lawful and protected activities such as strikes and picketing. In other words, he has no problem with people walking off a job and marching with signs to, for instance, force employers to bargaining for better wages. That's about it. And no less ironically so, considering strikes and picketing inflict economic damage from lost labor. A lot of people misunderstand this bill. They think it's an assault on the right to protest, which is not, Erickson continued. He's basically just saying, you cannot harm other people. And in Washington state, we're seeing organized groups forming to abuse the protest system against our energy infrastructure. And that's really where this bill started from. The last point of the impetus for crafting legislation to criminalize constitutionally protected behavior markedly demonstrates the potential for the law to be applied with too much broad a brush. For instance, should legislator North Dakota decide to draft a copycat measure, every water protector in the Standing Rock Sioux tribe and each supporter hoping to halt construction of the Dakota Access Pipeline to be considered an economic terrorist, despite the pipeline's intended transportation for crude for export. Indeed, that's the danger inherent in vaguely but vociferously worded legislation, the tangible potential it will be misinterpreted, or perhaps interpreted correctly and used against those who otherwise file prohibitions on violence and property destruction in protesting. Similarly, poorly thought out legislation has already been tested in Oklahoma with predictably astonishing results. Environmental activist Mariah Stevenson and Stephen Warner were arrested and charged with committing a terrorism hoax after unfurling a glitter-laden banner at the Oklahoma City headquarters of fracking giant Devon Energy. Neither perpetrated any violence, neither vandalized or destroyed property, neither harmed anyone nor anything. But Stevenson and Warner each initially faced a maximum penalty of 10 years in prison. In the first test of the Narragansett state law, eventually the terrorism hoax charges were downgraded to disorderly conduct and ultimately dismissed. But what came to be called Glittergate stretched the bounds of interpretation of law, particularly in regard to terrorism, and present a prime example for why Erickson's legislation is not just unnecessary, it's dangerously chilling for constitutional rights. As Tech Dirt aptly pointed out, the state senator has not provided information indicating who precisely would determine when protesting crosses the line into economic terrorism, and that could have indescribably terrible results. Great. Let's just leave it in the hands of law enforcement, which has always been wonderful, which allows to exercise its own discretion, Tim Crushing snarkily wrote for TechDirt. Give them a Blue Lives Matter law and they'll throw the book at every drunken arrestee who calls them names. Give them latitude to decide when picketing crosses into economic terrorism, and I'm sure they'll make the right call. Indeed, because Erickson's bill, conceived as an indignant response to anti-Trump support protests in Washington and around the country, is so loosely structured and ambiguous, it's likely not to pass at all, no matter the support he claims to have received. Would it apply to a Trump protest? If they take it too far, it would apply to him, Erickson told Fox News. A statement from the American Civil Liberties Union Communications Director Doug Hong, cited by Fox News, said we're already concerned that some of its loose terms appear to be targeting civil disobedience as terrorism. It is the kind of excessive approach to peaceful protests that our country and state do not need. Erickson's response to that statement proves he fails to comprehend the legislation he's proposing. In fact, the example of the senator highlighted as protected under economic terrorism bill, lunch counter protests of the civil rights movement during the 1960s disrupted economic activity by design, which is why those protests greatly contributed to a favorable outcome. African Americans disrupted businesses, hitting owners in their wallets to affect serious reform. Hopefully, cooler heads will prevail in the Washington state legislature when the bill is formally proposed, and lawmakers will have the foresight to see the exceedingly negative repercussions of criminalizing protests. Yeah, so, of course, in their own state constitution, he has to abide by that, too. So if that law violates their own supreme law of their particular state, it will be considered null and void. And the question is, was this lobbied to him, to State Senator Erickson? I wouldn't be surprised one bit by these big corporations. You never know. So the whole thing is, you gotta really focus on it. And I don't know why he's talking about it, and it's not even on his face yet. Then he can address it. So it's more like a potluck, kind of, sort of. So the whole thing is, we have to look at the bigger picture. And I like reading this stuff here from the 42nd Legislative District. And he serves Whatcom County, including Bellingham, Blaine, Everson, Ferndale, Leiden, Nooksack, and Sumas. And it's interesting here when he talks about the felony class C. I like this second to last paragraph. The penalties apply not to just participants, but those who fund, organize, sponsor, or otherwise encourage others to commit acts of economic terrorism. Accomplices may be required to pay restitution up to triple the amount of economic damages. So he's probably seeing in this area too on who's funding these individuals. There's a lot of speculations and some memorable information pertaining to that. Like George Soros, he says one of them. Yeah. So just to give you an example. Oh, we have to really, the people in the state of Washington, it's going to be talked about around the country when the session over there starts. But you got to keep your eyes on this in that particular area and be careful of replicas around the country. Because if they bring it into the state of Florida, if I read, I'll be calling those bastards out immediately. So you got to find out what is happening in those areas. So, oh, as I say, my friends, pay attention, observe responsibly. All right, next one here. Yeah, I know you're hearing some music in the background. It's I'm at the Broward Public Library, pretty cool place. And next one here is came from the Miami Herald, came out yesterday by David Smiley and Chris Rabin Smiley. Miami police knew for years that homicide evidence container was rotting. As I read here, Miami police brass knew at least 4 years ago that a storage unit warehousing evidence from hundreds of homicides or unclassified death cases was deteriorating and allowed the problem to fester until it became an emergency. But 1 month after the Miami police chief publicly admitted that rodents and the elements had spoiled some of the items stored in the rotting container, and asserted he acted as soon as he learned of the problem. Investigators going piece by piece through the content of 564 potential affected cases have yet to determine the full consequences of the police department's inaction. I can't tell you about a specific case that has been damaged or hasn't been damaged, said Police Chief Rodolfo Leonis, who himself noted the container was rotting in a 2012 memo back when he was an assistant chief. That's a long-term process to audit the actual evidence there to say that was compromised, and now we have to make a disclosure about it. Miami police declined to release its list of evidence contained in the storage unit, nor would the department provide it a list of the cases involved to the Miami Herald. But so far, Leanna said, investigators auditing the contents of the locker have narrowed their focus to around 100 cases. About two dozen of the have been identified as high priority due to their relation to closed criminal cases, although police and prosecutors say they have yet to find anything that would damage or jeopardize an open case or a conviction. Some of the cases, many homicides are considered cold cases and date back to the 1970s. Yeah, still, Lieutenant Carlos Castellanos, Miami heads of homicide, acknowledges that it may be years before police truly determine the extent of the damage, if any, to pass a future convictions, given the possibility that defense attorneys could make issues of the condition of the department's evidence when fighting prosecutions or appeals. Yeah, hold on here. Yeah, you hear people's conversations, so I gotta laugh. That's okay, no big deal. But and I look here, I can't predict what a defense attorney will or won't file because of what's in the container, Castellano said. Kept beneath the elevated portion of Interstate 95 that passes over downtown Miami and next to the police headquarters, and now replacing the discarded air-conditioned storage container, served as a reservoir for evidence from homicides and unclassified deaths spanning four decades, according to Miami Police. The unit, which was one of the several locations for storing homicide evidence, held items like clothing and furniture, but not as drugs, guns, or cash, Castellano said. It did not hold evidence used in the criminal prosecution, since those items are typically transferred to the possession of the Miami-Dade clerk of courts before trial. All right, so it says here, the steel container was overseen by the department's property unit, and brass have blamed the deterioration of the container and the evidence inside on poor communication, lack of oversight, and the glacial pace of government. Leanna said last month that the city hired a firm to audit the police department's practices and review what happened, but it doesn't appear the city will play a public game of who dropped the ball. I don't need an investigation to tell me there was a malpractice in the storage of valuable documents and evidence, said Horatio Stewart Aguirre, chairman of Miami's Civilian Investigative Panel, while adding, if I were the families of the deceased and the evidence was in those shipping containers, I'd be furious. Lance, who released a YouTube video last month in which he said he learned the problem from September 22nd, says he reacted promptly after receiving a call from Castellanos. He says he wasn't lying about his previous knowledge about the storage unit's condition, but was referring to the date on which he realized his department had an emergency on his hands. It's always treated as a maintenance issue until Castellanos called. There were budget issues. There were all kinds of issues that got in the way of this process. There were They were procured wrongly, said Leonis. I didn't lie to anybody. I'm not that guy. I don't hide the ball from anybody. I trust that we have a chief that knows what he's doing. That's City Manager Daniel Alfonso. But it's clear now that the police knew the storage container needed to be replaced at least 4 years ago. Internal police documents obtained a blogger, Al Crespo show the police department knew for years they had a problem and even filled out purchase orders for replacement that never came. In one 2012 memo obtained by Crespo, Leonis himself noted that an unannounced inspection of the department's property until found the container was rotting and in need of replacement. In another memo sent nearly 3 years later to Leonis, now the chief of police department's property unit wrote that the container needed to be replaced immediately as a condition has devolved to the point that evidence has been exposed to the environment, causing it to become damaged and or destroyed. The memo included a purchase order for a new unit. It was always treated as a maintenance issue. There were budget issues. There were all kinds of issues that got in the way of all of this process, Chief Adolfo Leonis. But for reasons not entirely clear, police didn't receive authorization to purchase and receive a replacement for the deteriorating storage unit for another year. The city issued a solicitation in January, and the commission approved a $65,700 expense in June with zero mention of contaminated evidence for two new containers. The police said they received the replacement around the time that Castellanos and several detectives visited the container in September to go through some cold cases and were shocked by what they saw. For now, it appears Miami's elected officials are reserving judgment at least until they learn the extent of the consequences. The problem did not come up during last week's city commission meeting, as several commissioners told the Miami Herald they hadn't spoken to Leonis and didn't know enough about the contents of the container to condemn the department. With Miami City Manager Daniel Alfonso, who appointed Leonis as chief, finds the incident embarrassing but continues to support Miami's top cop. I trust that we have a chief that knows what he's doing, he said. I'm solidly supporting him. Well, I know one thing. Some people are probably pissed off at him, too. So, hey, man, city government knows best, right? They're going to try to tell you guys what to do. They can't even clean their own houses. I'm sorry. Hey, man, you can't get a pit bull because it's dangerous, but it's okay for them to leave public information rotting to hell. I'm sorry. That's Miami-Dade County, too, so. But City of Miami, I just find it, like, wow, man, pretty disturbing. But, well, we're just going to find out what will be their refutal when it actually comes out and how accurate it really is, right? All right, well, you know what? Enough of that. Next one here, I'm going to go to trueactivist.com. Came out today. And I think the person who wrote this, his name is, one moment, Brianna Acosta. Okay, Mr. Acosta, thank you for your time. And this one's here, Anonymous joins DAPL fight by shutting down website that supplies police with grenades. And it says here, were particularly injured on Sunday night, so Anonymous had to inflict harm on the grenade provider. What occurred on Sunday night at the Standing Rock Indian Reservation was a brutal use of force that showed the true colors of the oil companies backing the Dakota Access Pipeline and local police. It's been clear which side the police have been on from the start, but up until now, the assault on protesters have been relatively mild and spread out. However, on Sunday night, chaos ensued when law enforcement pulled out all the stops in an effort to persuade protesters to end their fight. Police used rubber bullets, water cannons, and concussion grenades to cause non-lethal harm to the water protectors, but the damage inflicted was massive. Reportedly, a shot a 13-year-old girl in the face, the rubber bullets vindictively shot a man at point-blank range in the belly button and kneecaps with a smile on their face, and to cause two elderly tribe members to go into cardiac arrest. They used water cannons to hose down the protesters trying to move past a barricaded bridge, and many of them were sent to the hospital for hypothermia because of the sub-freezing temperatures. Concussion grenades are non-lethal explosives that stun victims and leave them without their senses temporarily as it releases a blinding flash of light accompanied by a piercing bang. Though the local police denied using them during this attack, evidence of their use has been brought forward by one woman who was critically injured by one. A 21-year-old woman was hit directly in the arm with one, which caused all the muscle and soft tissue between her elbow and wrist be blown away. Her father laminated. If her multiple surgeries don't go away, she will need to have her arm amputated. Notorious Hacktivist Anonymous come forward to aid in the fight against DAPL police by knocking Safari Land offline, the website that supplies law enforcement with tear gas, concussion grenades, and non-lethal weapons. They were used on Sunday night. The assault on Sunday lasted approximately 6 hours long and injured about 160 people. Unicorn Riot, a volunteer-based media collective, was reporting live when the attack broke out, returned to the scene of the commotion on Monday morning to gather evidence. They found spent munitions shells with markings from Safariland and fragments of Stinger grenades, which police say were not used. They claim that injuries obtained by explosives on the fateful night have been just caused by explosives brought by other protesters. Anonymous activist DedSec took credit for the takedown on Twitter and said, "Tango down, stop selling weapons being used against border protectors." The user also tagged several accounts, including Unicorn Riot and the No DAPL account. Though moves like this may seem small, hours or even minutes of being offline can harm a business and even cause them to reconsider their involvement in this movement. Well, 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 the cyber wars, my friend. That's another form of rebellion. And, hey, you want to support the police state military police complex? It's going to blow back in your faces when least expect it. That's a good thing. But even with the folks out there are still trying to keep things peaceful, man, put them in your thoughts and prayers and blessings. Especially on this so-called holiday, the Thanksgiving Day holiday, they need to be talked about at the dinner table and even before and after. Because, like I said before, I stress this, it affects every single one of us. But one day, how about they put a pipeline at a burial site where one particular group, pay their respects at. They wouldn't like it. So you gotta really think of it in the bigger picture. This is why, because, oh yeah, do the pipeline. You know what? There's others, it's the right technology's gone. Someday we don't need that. Like I said before, biomass, hemp fuel run engines, Henry Ford designed, Papa Mechanics. I know I said it probably my last episode, but look it up. Don't be shy. I learned that from The Emperor Wears No Clothes by the late Jack Hare. So put them in your thoughts, my friends. Don't sit there, do nothing, and spread this information like fire, all right? All right, speaking of Thanksgiving, let's just check this out here. It says, "Thanksgiving Ode to John Horse and the Black Seminoles" by William C. Anderson. Like it reads here, "An engraving of John Horse, the leader of the Black Seminoles, the two races, the Negro and the Indian, are rapidly approximating. They are identified in interests and feelings. should the Indians remain in this territory, the Negroes among them will form a rallying point for runaway Negroes from the adjacent states, and should they remove the fastnesses of the country, will be immediately occupied by Negroes. This is by U.S. General Thomas S. Jessup. And as it reads here, most people who don't know who John Horse is, it's not because he deserves to be overlooked, but because the United States history has a way of conveniently forgetting some people, places, things, and occurrences. By John Horse, a man of many names, Juan Cavallo, John Kawaya, and Gopher John, all spelled in various ways, is an extremely important person to remember, especially right now. More importantly, he wasn't just one man. He represented a movement that stretched far across the Americas. Today, that movement, John Horse's story, and the people who empowered him represented one of the greatest rebellions in this country has ever known. We will do well to deliver them in remembrance. That is their proper inheritance. The Black Seminoles form, which was one of the many rebel communities across South Central North America. Rebel communities made up of escaped slaves, often known as Maroons, represented a particular threat to white development during earlier times of conquest, colonization, and chattel slavery. These communities were often made up of both black and indigenous populations that built allegiances, families, and relationships that were a danger to the stability of white dominance. Therefore, they were of the utmost importance to destroy. The Black Seminoles' relationship with the Seminole tribe itself was complicated, to at least, and there's still to this day, the official Seminole Tribe of Florida website still reflects this tension. It includes a nonchalant definition of a Black Seminole that states, this is a misnomer, a term sometimes confuses more than it explains. That definition is quickly followed by an extremely condensed version of an expansive story, just two short paragraphs. Around the time of the Revolutionary War, escaped slaves and Seminoles formed strategic alliances to fight against the colonists. Though they weren't necessarily strangers to each other beforehand, in the early 1800s, some Seminoles were taking refugees seeking Africans as their own slaves, and though these Africans had some freedoms they wouldn't have had under white enslavement, but they were nevertheless still denied true freedom. A feudalistic model of sorts allowed black people enslaved by the Seminoles to possess land, property, and some relative autonomy in return for whatever those enslaved had to offer the tribe. Even now, black Seminole descendants are treated as outsiders and have been excluded from tribal recognition and the benefits that come with it. John Horse was not necessarily the most important leader of the black Seminoles, but his lengthy list of achievements and his daring story given him a special place in black Seminole history. A website dedicated to the Black Seminoles and particular John Horse states, over a long life, he defeated leading U.S. generals, met two presidents, served as an advisor to the Seminoles chief, a scout for the U.S. Army, and a decorated officer in the Mexican military. He defended free black settlements on three frontiers and was said to love children, whiskey, and his noble white horse, American. In 1882, he fulfilled his quest for a free homeland with the final act of his life, securing a land grant in northern Mexico. His descendants live on that land grant to this day. When John Horse was born, the U.S. was in turmoil, fighting the British for the second time in the War of 1812. Andrew Jackson was a national hero during this war, but he never knew he would be a president or cross paths with the likes of John Horse. Horse's mother was a black woman who may or may not have been owned by his father, Charles Cavallo, who was Seminole. John Horse and his mother would ultimately have to flee the advance of Andrew Jackson and his troops during the First Seminole War. Keep in mind that the U.S. was working to seize Florida from Spain, recaptured escaped slaves, and brutalized native populations there. Later then, when then President Andrew Jackson signed a Indian Removal Act for the displacement of all native peoples to land west of the Mississippi, many Seminoles decided to resist. John Horse website states, there's a link for that. For black Seminoles, Jackson's inauguration was a nightmare. The man who had ordered the destruction of the Negro fort, burned their settlements on the Suwannee, and brought Southern-style slavery to Florida was now at the peak of national power. As he'd done since 1815, Jackson would try to break up the Seminole Maroon settlements and force the blacks into Southern-style bondage. In 1835, black and Seminole forces who had grown tired of tensions with U.S. forces launched the Second Seminole War. Under the leadership of the black warrior John Caesar and the Seminole King Philip, they burnt several plantations, homes, and mills while recruiting more of the enslaved to join them. Seminole leaders Osceola, King Philip, and Wildcat had refused to quietly give up their land, and John Horse was among them in this respect. For years, blacks, Seminoles, and other natives across Florida and other places in the U.S. fought alongside one another against the United States military, successfully holding them off from achieving their goal of land seizure and further enslavement. In Florida, these forces struck fear into a U.S. military that didn't have nearly as much to lose as these black Seminoles, whom white invaders labeled just as Negroes and sometimes Indian Negroes. They were predominantly identified by their blackness, even if they were mixed race. Understanding this is important because it meant division and a treatment at the hands of white forces. Black Seminoles were fighting against being returned to slavery or killed, while Seminoles were fighting against being displaced or killed. Statue of John Horse and other black Seminole leaders prefixed with their white foes. Even though Horse and others were often technically owned by their Seminole counterparts, they were given respected status for their numerous skills and resources they brought to their respective tribal associations. Lieutenant John T. Sprague described it as the slave becoming the master. When witnessing black Seminoles like John Horse and other black leaders of this ilk negotiate on behalf of the Seminoles. Moreover, in discussing a perceived difference based on the gaze on white onlookers like himself, Sprague said, the Negroes from the commencement of the Florida War have, for their numbers, been the most formidable foe, more bloodthirsty, active, and revengeful than the Indian. They were a most cruel and malignant enemy. For them to surrender, there would be servitude to the whites, but to retain an open warfare secure them to plunder, liberty, and importance. U.S. military had grown weary of the fighting the black Seminoles and were especially scared of the black Seminole rebellion spreading. They worried it would upend slavery. General Thomas Sidney Jessup hoped to separate the black Seminole and the Seminole resistance that the U.S. had absolutely failed to quell or effectively control. In 1836, Jessup stated, "This, you may be assured, is a Negro, not an Indian war. And if not, be speedily put down, the South will feel the effects of it on their slave population before the end of the next season." Then, realizing that this enemy could be defended through war, he offered freedom instead. Jessup issued what would be the first Emancipation Proclamation, saying all Negroes, the property of the Seminole, who deliver themselves up to the commanding officers of the troops, should be free. that predated Lincoln's emancipation by 25 years marked a successful slave rebellion that was only ended with concession on behalf of white enslavers. The black Seminole had won to a large extent. Perhaps Jessup was forced to confront slave owners with the harsh reality that these people could not be conquered and that property was not the prior over peace. Black Seminoles resisted in Florida for many decades, and for at least some at that time. John Horace tried working with the system. After being captured in 1838, he agreed to relocate some of his people. The relocation, like many relocations of Native people during this time, was filled with deception and broken promises about the land, comfort, and stability. After working as a guide and negotiator for the U.S. Army, seeing nothing good coming of it for his people, he unsuccessfully petitioned the government for better treatment of the black Seminoles, who were hungry and still under the threat of slave catchers. John Horace was free thanks to his service and by his father's will, but his people did not hold the same privileges as him. After being asked to help return many of his people to the former owners, he began his resistance yet again. He and the Seminole leader Wildcat, who had often advocated for black Seminoles within the tribe, led a mass exodus to Mexico, effectively freeing many black Seminoles and securing a land grant return for John Horse's allegiance to the Mexican military, which was fighting the Apache and Comanche. Horse would spend the remainder of his life defending, advocating on behalf of, and leading his people in Mexico and Texas. He traveled back and forth between Mexico and the United States for the rest of his life, visiting Mexico City and Washington, D.C. to lobby on behalf of the people until he died. Black Seminole's lengthy list of accomplishments changed the course of history, including setting the precedent for the Emancipation Proclamation. To this day, there are black Seminole communities in Florida, Texas, Mexico, called Massachusetts, the Bahamas, and elsewhere. In a time when allyship, sacrifice, and resistance are all urgently necessary, the black Seminoles all offer key examples. They led the most successful slave rebellion in the U.S. White domination of historical narratives often excludes stories like this. Now is the time to lift them up. Moving forward into the coming years, it will be extremely important to recognize history like this, sometimes complicated and contentious. Relationships between black and brown people should not be overlooked, nor should they be overly romanticized. What should be known is that here in the U.S. South, there was a time when blacks and natives rode together and brought an entire white establishment to his knees. It is interesting because I've read stuff like this and see some cool films on this like 25 years ago, I would say. And another good thing too, I read that you look up. I might look that up and do a footnote on the Battle of Lake Okeechobee. I'm gonna do that right now. So see if I get this. And it's a real unique history, what they achieved on defeating the U.S. military, because this is. I do have to say, you know, it is important because when it comes to tyranny, people have to find out ways of revolting, resisting, regardless what you look like and so forth. So I'm going to, right here, the Battle of Lake Okeechobee, 1837. And there's a video on that too. So I'm definitely going to add this link here for it. And I'm going to add the video too so you can folks check it out. And it's really unique. So I'm always appreciate history in these areas. It's actually a reenactment. So I'll put that in the footnotes as well. Because everyone has a right to know what is actually happening. So like remember Jefferson says, right? The little rebellion now and then is good. And we need, and right now, based on the global state, global police state, it's getting more enhanced. You know, like trying to put us all in that technocratic plantation. And so that is all for now. I'd like to thank everyone for listening to this show. Plus, feel free to download and share this throughout your social media networks. If you have any questions, comments, or you want to send me something interesting that I may be interested in, whatever you do, please send your correspondences with decorum. You can hit me on Facebook, Twitter, Google Plus, Spreaker, iHeartRadio, Tumblr, YouTube, Freedoms Network, and Scene.life. Or you can email me at LokiLuck3, which is Loki Luck and the number three altogether at gmail.com. So whatever you do, if you're gonna celebrate Thanksgiving, think about the brothers and sisters that are in the coal pipeline and across the world when it comes to victims of tyranny. Be blessed and stand up for what's right in your own particular avenues, what you're comfortable with. Okay? It is essential because the New World Order want us fighting amongst each other. They want so they can we can be conquered. It's happening around the world, regardless what your skin color is or national background, etc. I do mean that. All right, well, the song I'm gonna be playing, it's a little good set metal satire. It's a band called Zimmer's Hole. It was all members from Scrappy Young Lad, and them wasn't it. It was pretty fun when I heard this years ago. I'm like, yeah, I'm gonna play it. It's been a while. It's called When You're Shouting at the Devil, We're in a League with Satan. Nothing serious or anything like that. It's good, clean fun. So, entertainment just has some vulgarity in it. But I'm just giving you a heads up, right? So enjoy the weekend. Whatever you do, don't go crazy on that Black Friday. If you're in the United States waiting in line for Walmart to get that real crappy product and see people get trampled over, it's totally retarded and mind is a mind control program. The bottom line is this: they need you more you need them. Plain and simple. All right? Okay, my friends, once again, thank you for your time. Plus, always remember that demoniac resistance is healthy for the soul and can liberate humanity. Until next time, take care of yourselves, keep on spreading the love, and may your guardian spirits be with you.